thatgreatbusinessshow.com is brought to you by De Facto Shaving Oil, the best anyone can get. Made in Ireland, sold worldwide.
Welcome to thatgreatbusinessshow.com, episode 48 of the podcast where we do business differently. I am Conall O Móráin, known on Twitter as @ConallOM. And as always, as I do say, do follow us on LinkedIn, where we have great conversations with past, present and future guests. And it's where you can find updates on what's coming up on future shows, our sneak peeks, as we like to call them. This week, we have a potpourri of businesses and business advice, from an award-winning beer that's good for your health, a book on how to supercharge your business, and a gorgeous, very early stage business that wants to grow forests in the middle of cities. All of these great stories are made possible thanks to the support of our wonderful sponsor, De Facto Shave. Made in Mayo, it's the world's best shaving oil. 20 million shaving foam cans go into landfill in Ireland every year. All totally avoidable by switching to De Facto, which is great for your skin, your wallet, and your planet.
Backing great women-led businesses on every show. That Great Business Show.
That, if you didn't know, is megastar Rita Ora singing about that great business show that she quite correctly says is hot right now. She's a very discerning lady, is Rita, but unfortunately she cannot be with us today because she's in discussions with our first company, the Naked Collective, regarding a big promotion they're planning. The Naked Collective is a Kildare-based drinks company that makes a beverage called Mude that Rita seems to like very much. And she said as much to her 16 million followers. They also have another award-winning beer called So.Beer. One of the co-founders of the company, Niall Phelan, is currently with Rita, so we're lucky to have the other co-founder with us on That Great Business Show, and she is Catherina Butler, better known as Cat. Cat was previously a financial controller at Lifestyle Sport, something called a Business Navigator with IKEA, or IKEA as they like to call themselves, Finance Director at United Drugs, CFO at logistics company Primeline. So as you can see, all in all, nothing at all to do with a drinks company, and we just love that. Welcome to That Great Business Show, Cat Butler.
Thank you very much, and I'm delighted to be here.
Well, you could have been off, instead of being with us, you could have been with Rita Ora, so you did draw the short straw.
No, absolutely not. I think I got the long straw. Thanks very much.
Tell me, what is your co-founder, Niall Phelan, doing with Rita Ora? What is the little plan? What is the promotion that you're... It's a big one, actually. What is the big promotion about?
So we're collaborating with Rita on a live stream event. And unfortunately, Conall, that's all I can say until Monday. We're absolutely delighted to be in collaboration with Rita, a small, you know, growing startup Irish business. To be collaborating with Rita Ora is a real privilege.
And thank you so much for setting up my next question, because how in the name of does a small startup like yours get involved with Rita Ora? She is mega.
She is mega. And, you know, what we love about Rita is that she herself is a very humble person. She's a hard worker. And obviously, as an Irish, you know, growing drinks brand, we look for, you know, ambassadors that can help us to grow our brand, that can help us to get our message out there. What she loves about us is the fact that we are a truly healthy, clean product. You know, we are really all about sustainability and, you know, plant-based products.
How did you get her? That's really what I'm trying to find out.
Well, that is a mystery that shall remain with me, I'm afraid, Conall.
Oh, well, that means you're going to get the hard questions.
I was expecting them.
Well, tell us all about the Naked Collective. You know you're going to have a problem when you are emailing the States, because if you put naked into an email, it'll go into spam.
Well, you know, we've come across that already, and so we've actually been able to address it. And we were unsure initially why some of our emails got blocked. But an amazing IT company that supports us here, Ortiz, resolved that for us. So thankfully, we've gotten over that challenge. But one of the many challenges, I guess, that you face as an Irish startup.
You had proper jobs.
I did.
CFO of United Drug is a real job.
Mm.
What madness made you jump ship and go into something, I'm going to say it, that you know nothing at all about?
Well, I can tell you this.
You probably know now because you've been at it for a while.
Well, but, you know, my background, I come from an entrepreneurial background and I always... My dad had his own business down in County Kerry. He set it up when he was in his 30s. And so I always knew that I'd have my own business someday.
So what was that business?
A garage. In Listowel. That's now being run actually by my brother. So passed down to the next generation. And I spent 20 years preparing myself for eventually running my own business.
Every day while you were being CFO here, there and everywhere else, were you honestly thinking about that you could actually get involved in this?
I think I knew I was preparing myself for something else, something bigger, something whereby I could really live out my own true values. I guess, you know, finance for me was a real building block in terms of, you know, getting that experience in the world of business. And I was very fortunate to work for some amazing, amazing businesses.
But were you thinking all of the time that, you know, I'm going to jump?
No, because, you know, as a focused person, when I was in a role, I was in a role. I was learning, I was developing, I was growing. I had the fortune, you know, the good fortune to work with some amazing business people who taught me and who coached me and who helped me along the way.
Did they all think you're mad having jumped to go into
making drinks? Well, I don't know now, Conall. You'd have to ask them that. But I guess, you know, you wouldn't be, you know, I suppose you wouldn't be jumping ship unless you felt really strongly about the consumer proposition. And I guess I was very fortunate to come across and meet my business partner, my now business partner, Niall Phelan, when I worked in Primeline. And, you know, almost immediately we realized that we could do something great together.
And I'm always fascinated by what was the chat. Were you sitting having a cup of coffee and saying, Niall, did you ever think of a clean drink that we could manufacture?
Well, I think we started out with, you know, I guess a really good working relationship in terms of, you know, when you come across somebody that you admire and respect, you think they're a great, you know, person and, you know, you have that spark in terms of, you know, being able to work together. We were, you know, similar age profiles, early 40s, looking for something different. We sat down, started to do some brainstorming, understood that we had very similar values in terms of, you know, wanting to do something, leave a legacy behind us that we were proud of. You know, my background very much finance, Niall's background sales and marketing. So between us, you know, we make a really, really good team when it comes to running a business.
Tell the truth. Did you get sick of finance?
I still do finance. Finance permeates everything that we all do. You never really leave finance behind.
And what was the conversation on the last day? Did you both walk out the door the same day?
No, absolutely not. It evolved. So we were working on kind of plans and brands and ideas for some time before we set the company up. So we incorporated the Naked Collective in November 2019. At that point, we had some ideas in terms of, you know, we knew, you know, the core principles that we were going to found the business on. We knew that we were going to provide consumers with a real tangible alternative to the unhealthy sugary drinks that you find in the retail stores, you know, today. And that was, you know, a passion of mine in terms of health and well-being.
Where did that come from?
You know, I have a 10-year-old daughter and,
give
you know,
her her name because she'll
Sophie.
Love this.
Sophie, she is my pride and joy.
She was meant to be with us today.
She was meant to be with us today, but when I went to collect her, she was going off and she goes to a childminder during
the
summer.
She got a better offer.
She got a better offer and I was ditched, but I guess I better get used to that. So, you know, health and wellness, I guess, when you have a child, you know, every parent, you know, wants to provide the very best for their children. I started to get very interested in looking at the labels on products, you know, and, you know, giving her sugary drinks was never, you know, never a viable option for me. And what better way to address the issues, you know, in a category than to go off and develop a product yourself? And that's where it was born from. Niall has two daughters, similarly minded in terms of health and well-being. And so, you know, it evolved really, really quickly. His background is brewing, so we know that brew drinks are much better for you. The word mood is really, you know, it's easy to explain. It's your mood. And it's also
spelled
naked.
M-U-D-E.
M-U-D-E, which is coined from nude, as in naked, and your mood. So our functional drinks really address kind of issues that consumers have throughout the day. So if you
Has your daughter yet told you that you have spelt mood incorrectly?
No, she hasn't actually.
She will.
Not yet. But I'm expecting it when she listens to this.
Or if you're with Dublin people, they'll talk to you about your mute.
Your mute, exactly.
So look at it. It's a crowded marketplace. Mm-hmm. How do you put up your elbows and grow and get the space? It's all up, well, a lot of it is about supermarket shelf space, isn't it?
Absolutely. I guess, you know, it's about having a proposition that's really relevant for customers. And we all knew, you know, even before COVID hit, health and wellness and, you know, it was a real high priority for everybody. You know, people are very time poor. So they look to their food and their drinks for, you know, a way of, you know, improving their health and well-being. You know, market research tells us, thankfully, that, you know, attitudes to alcohol are changing. So providing consumers with a product that's truly healthy, you know, that's made without any artificial ingredients, no added sugar, you know, you're looking at about 7 or 8 grams of sugar, 40 calories. You know, the consumer proposition is, you know, is there. And we were also really fortunate to be picked up by some of the big retailers in Ireland. So we've
now
had
you
support.
Say fortunate, that just doesn't happen.
Hard for it, but we, you know, we've had support, you know, from Irish businesses.
You better name those who have supported you too.
Absolutely. Early days, Spar and BWG. You know, we're very similarly aligned in terms of our values. You know, our sustainability messaging is closely aligned, and they got behind us and they listed us very early on. So we're very grateful for that. They've also actually put us through for the Spar International Challenger brand program.
What is that? I haven't come across that.
Yeah, that's where head office and Spar in Amsterdam, you know, go through a process every year where they choose some brands and then they promote those brands to all of their, you know, 13,500 stores across 48 countries. That was pretty amazing.
Are you on that or have you made the list?
We're on that. We were visiting them actually only a couple of weeks ago. So there's lots of activity going to happen across a number of the regions in the coming months. So Mude and So.Beer will be on shelves across the Spar network in the coming months.
Has that got anything to do with Rita?
Well, it didn't initially, but I can say that who doesn't love Rita?
Well, everybody seems to love Rita.
Absolutely.
She only sells millions and billions of
absolutely
songs or records or whatever one buys nowadays. The Spar one, though, are you going to be in 30? Did you say 13.5?
No, we are. They have a real estate of about 13,500 stores across 38 countries. It gives us access to those retailers. Now, you know, we'll be entering into the markets that we have an existing route to market where we have a distributor already set up. So today we're selling in Ireland, we're selling in the UK, we're selling in Italy, and also the US and Canada. And we're engaging with other regions at the minute to try and, you know, get our products on their shelves also.
Which is grand and dandy until you have to supply, i.e. produce this stuff. Where are you producing?
We produce in a number of locations at the minute. We're producing in a couple of locations in the UK. We produce in Mississippi in the US and we produce in Niagra Falls in Canada.
Wow. Mm. That is fantastic. I love this idea. Mm. When you say that you're producing in the UK, then distribution out of there across Europe, Brexit must have done your head in.
Absolutely. But,
Discuss, please.
I guess initially we were challenged. You know, our product is packed in a sleek can. So to get the capacity and the, you know, the production capability, we had to go to the UK. Our long-term plan is that we produce as close to the local market as we possibly can to reduce down our carbon footprint. One of our core, you know, reasons for being in business is to try and, you know, positively impact climate change to be a really regenerative business.
Can you do it in the Coca-Cola model? And I know that you probably spit those two words out, but as in with a concentrate, could you bring a concentrate to, say, Netherlands or Slovakia or wherever?
There's lots of different things we could do and that we're reviewing to try and minimize, you know, the production process. We're very much at the, I suppose, the startup phase. So we're selling in 5 countries. you know, as volumes grow, obviously, you know, the way that we produce, how we produce becomes more effective and more efficient. And that will all happen in time. So we are, you know, we make our decisions with the lens of sustainability firmly in focus.
If you are, you've outsourced mm-hmm. your manufacturing, what is the actual business? Who's down in Kildare? There's you, there's Niall, mm-hmm. but Niall isn't even in Kildare anymore.
No,
because
he's not.
You were telling me that he's actually made a big leap.
Yes.
And it's a big ask.
Absolutely.
We had Aidan Meegan of Natterjack Whiskey on quite some months ago, and he was heading to the States. Mm. And your Niall has gone to the States.
He's just gone. He's just landed, actually.
He's down in Tampa, Florida, you told me.
He is indeed. So he's just set up home there with his wife and his two teenage daughters. So it was a massive move. I guess, you know, the opportunity for us is not just in EMEA or Europe, but it's also in the US and Canada. And we felt that we needed to have a presence out there to be able to engage with the retailers, to be able to drive the strategy from a local perspective. So Niall is the guy that's gone. He's amazing to do it. So we're delighted to have him out there. We miss him, of course, but it means we can get out to see him, hopefully, when the restrictions ease.
Were you given the opportunity, or how did you draw straws on that?
I think it kind of just naturally occurred that way, is how I would put it.
Okay, well, we'll leave that. I'd say there were some boardroom discussions about that one. So then the plans, so we'll talk about So.Beer first mm-hmm. of all, and then we'll go on to the future plans. Mm-hmm. So.Beer is a healthy beer.
That's right. So we produce So.Beer in a different way to most other non-alcoholic beers. So we use a different process through the brewing house. So we brew to purpose. So we never create alcohol. Most other non-alcoholic beers create, you know, they brew alcohol, they strip the alcohol out, and then they put in artificial flavors and other products to help it taste more like a beer. We don't do that. So we brew, we extract the vitamins and minerals from the grains. They are retained in the liquid. And then we add our ImmunoBoost technology. So actually drinking a So.Beer improves your immune system. It can help to improve your immune system. And it's an absolutely great tasting beer. And of course, we won an award for that beer earlier this year.
Any little award. Talk to me about the award.
Yes, it was the World Food Innovation Award.
That is a big one.
It is a big one, and we were absolutely thrilled to get it.
But you couldn't have been there, were you? No.
No, everything was virtual.
Oh,
absolutely.
That's like winning your Academy Award and not being able to give a gushy speech.
And speaking of Academy Awards, we had Mude at the Oscars also
did
earlier.
You? We did. How did you get in there?
Well, we were spotted.
If you're not going to tell me about how you got onto Rita.
Well, listen, I have a bit more flexibility on this one, so I can tell you that one. We were picked up on a health and wellness magazine. We were featured over in the US.
Sorry. I know enough about this. You don't just get picked up. How did you get into the magazine? That's a job for somebody.
No, well, I guess we have, we really are leading the way in terms of health and wellness, in terms of, offering a consumer an alternative to what can be perceived as healthy, but not really healthy. So,
but others are there.
Well, they're not really. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. So we brew Mude. So we extract the vitamins and minerals from the grains, and then we add organic botanicals, BCAAs and other organic ingredients.
This is for Mude now or for So.Beer?
For Mude.
Okay. So it's a brewed product.
It's a brewed product. So it's an isotonic liquid. So actually the vitamins and minerals have far higher bioavailability than powdered vitamins, for example.
I'm going to cut across you because if I were to ask you 3 or 4 years ago about whatever those terms you've just used, would you have had an idea?
Well, I probably would have had some idea, not as much of an idea as I have
now. Bio what?
Bioavailability. So that means it's absorbed, you know, simply put, it's absorbed by your bloodstream.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So you get the benefit of those vitamins and minerals. And what you'll have also is, you know, health and wellness magazines looking for the next best health drink. And we were picked up in a magazine in the US. We were picked up in Men's Health magazine, actually, in the UK also quite recently, which is massive. And this is, you know, this is a huge, I suppose, positive for us. And it's also, you know, it's also humbling that, you know, magazines of this standing, you know, think that our products are great.
And in case anybody thinks that you have a small company, mm-hmm. you have already collected collected 6 million euro, and you're currently raising a further 6 million.
That's correct.
And what are you going to do with that besides going on tour to Tampa, Florida to visit Niall?
I certainly won't be doing that for any time soon until the restrictions are lifted, hopefully sooner rather than later. So we raised 6 million of investment last October. And that was, so we've got a really supportive group of investors, some based stateside, some here in Ireland.
Are you going to name those for me?
I'm not, but...
Good God, this conversation is kind of going down dead ends anyway.
I tell you, if I told you, I'd have to kill you. And we're now currently closing out another round. So that'll close out in the next couple of weeks for 6 million. And that money is being pumped directly into sales and marketing to grow our brands, to continue to grow our brand in Ireland, to grow our brand in the UK, Italy, and of course, North America, which is a really strategic focus for us at the moment.
And does that mean hiring people or how will you spend your millions?
I know.
You're going to give it to Rita. I've finally figured it out.
Oh my God. Cut. We've people out. We've people working in North America at the moment.
How many?
We have 8 people in North America. So split between Canada and the US. Our business model is an outsourced business model. So our focus is to leverage existing infrastructure, not to add to infrastructure unnecessarily. It does mean that we need to have people on the ground out there, and we will probably hire a few more people as the brands grow over time. But we also have a really good network of distributors that we work with who have got, you know, far more capability to drive that distribution for us than we could have if we had our own direct people out there. So it's a mix of both. It's our own people coupled with, you know, the distribution network that exists out there already.
So would you class yourself as an Irish company or a virtual company? It sounds very virtual to me.
Yeah, we are, absolutely. We hired all of our people on Teams. So we have people working in Ireland, the UK, Italy, Germany, the US, Canada. So everybody has been hired virtually. I would say we are an Irish headquartered company that has very much got an international feel. We communicate virtually every day. And it's amazing because we've set up all of our, you know, commercial arrangements, whether it be co-packers or distributors. We've done all that virtually. You know, so it is really, you know, it's really great to get back out and to start meeting people face to face. But I hope we never go back to the way it was before, you know, all the restrictions and flight restrictions.
Oh,
no, yeah. You know, we don't need to do that much travel to do business.
A couple of final questions. One, what can Team GBS, they are our listeners, what could they do for you?
Okay, I would say, try our products. Go into your local Spar store. We're in Spar, we're in Tesco's. We have about 1,000 outlets here in Ireland.
That's a lot.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a lot. In fact, you know, we've recently just gone into Lidl as well. Try our products and give us feedback. You know, tell your friends about it. Our business is, you know, set up to be a business that is profit with purpose so that we can help support local sustainability causes. Tell us what you think about it. Give us your feedback, you know, and, you know, be really honest with us. And that's what I would ask them to do.
Can investors get involved with your funding round?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I can give you my number if you want.
Okay. Because we had Norman Crowley of Crowley Carbon on, and this is an area that he absolutely loves.
Amazing.
So he may be of interest. So final question is, we always ask this, who would you hire in a heartbeat?
I'm really clear about this, actually. We've always wanted to do a collaboration with Roz Purcell for so many different reasons. She's an amazing Irish woman. She promotes really amazing body image for young women. She's plant-based. She's vegan. Niall and I are both vegan. You know, we are, and she really brings to fore the sustainability message. So I would love to do a collaboration with Roz Purcell.
Roz, I was going to say, if you're listening, of course she's listening. This is Ireland's best business podcast. You are wanted. You better give the good people down in Kildare a shout. She goes by Cat. Her real name is Catherina Butler. There's Niall Phelan. And they are jointly the Naked Collective, makers of Mude and So.Beer. I've got one final question, because I always ask you final questions. Have you got any further new products on the way?
We've lots of products in the pipeline. But It will be a couple of years before they hit the shelves. You know, we've got a big job to do on Mude and So.Beer, so we'll continue to do that. But definitely watch this space. You know, check us out on Instagram. You know, you'll find all of the information that you need there.
Cat Butler, thank you so much for joining us on That Great Business
You're
Show.
Welcome. It was a pleasure. Thank you so much.
ISME is the independent SME association, looking after the interests of all types of businesses across Ireland. ISME membership includes invaluable HR and general advice, training, promotional tools, members' discounts, events, and networking with fellow SMEs. ISME membership starts from €195 with easy pay options. ISME. Join today at isme.ie or email membership@isme.ie. ThatGreatBusinessShow.com is brought to you by De Facto Shaving Oil, the best anyone can get. Made in Ireland, sold worldwide.
We all want to do business better, and that's part of our mission here on That Great Business Show, to help businesses by finding people who have great business insights that they're happy to share. We haven't featured many business books recently, but it's something we'll be rectifying in coming episodes. Today, we have the author of a new book called Culture Matters, subtitled The Four Must-Have Values to Supercharge Your Business. The author is Alan O'Neill, Managing Director of CARA, with a K, Change Management. You may also know him from the weekly column he writes for the Sunday Independent. And over the years, he's worked with big name companies like Toyota, Dubai Duty Free, and Primark. And now he's putting his learnings into this, not his first, but his latest title. So let us find out what Alan's four secrets of Fatima are. Alan O'Neill, you are most welcome to That Great Business Show.
My pleasure to be here with you, Conall.
We are here to interrogate you.
Oh.
We are going to save people the price of the book. That's not the idea, is it?
Well, okay. Well, we'll give a few secrets away, but not them all then, Conall, if that's the case.
Okay, so tell us, secret one to supercharge a business is?
Well, this particular book is all about culture. And culture, of course, is often described as the way we do things around here, which is a combination of behaviours and processes in any organisation. And Conall, I guess from my experience over the years, to me, culture is the most important driver of business success, much more than strategy even.
When you are talking about culture, put words around that for me. What do you actually mean, culture?
Okay, so it's a set of behaviours, and probably the best way to explain this is the example that I use around values. So to me, working with organisations, in helping them to refresh their culture, I focus on values as being the spine for shaping a culture. Because, you know, you'll often hear culture described as aggressive or blame culture or coaching culture or a people culture or a customer culture. But that's all just very vague. And to really, really batten this down, I believe in using values as the framework. For example, Conall, you and I, we live our lives by a set of personal values that no doubt, undoubtedly, will include words like respect, integrity, honesty, benevolence, hard work ethic, and so on.
You must be talking about yourself.
So if we just take that example, one of those, take respect as an example. And I want to picture a scenario. Imagine you're going home this evening on the Lewis, and you jump on early here in Dundrum, and you get a seat. And as the train moves on its journey, it picks up more passengers, and now eventually there are no seats left. But you and I are sitting pretty, are chatting away. And then at the next stop, a pregnant woman or an elderly gentleman gets on board. Now, what do you do instinctively? Now, Conall, get this right. What do you do instinctively?
I am going to answer you. I would put my hand on my neck because that is where I would have been beaten as a child.
Well, to
get up and to offer your seat, of course.
There you go. Yeah. Of course you would, which is a behavior. Offering your seat is a behavior, which is a direct response to the situation you find yourself in. And that thing called respect triggers something in your mind to make you act in a certain way. Now, you scale that up. Organizations have now come to recognize that this is the secret to, if we want our people to be very much more customer focused, for example, or take much more ownership for what they do, or to move at a particular pace, well, the way to do that is by shaping a set of values and then embed them throughout the business. That's culture, because that brings then everybody in line with the particular way of doing things.
Sounds good.
Yeah.
How do you apply it? How do you get people to adopt it? Like, people are normal. They come in on a Monday, they've been thinking about the sick child, the dog needs a grooming, they have to get the child into a different school, the car probably needs replacing.
Sure, I get you. Yeah. You see, these are all real life realities that impact on anybody's behaviors. However, what you're trying to do is develop a consistency of a certain style of instinctive behaviors. And when you develop a culture around a set of values, no more than five, I would typically say four or five, Conall, that when you develop and really bring those to life throughout the business, for example, I would encourage when I'm working with companies to have them refresh their culture and shape their defined culture. That will then kick into recruitment. So when they're hiring people that fit best with the values, not just hiring based on a fantastic CV, because you could get somebody with a fantastic CV who's an ass working with next door. So you would hire people according to values. Not only that, you would also appraise people, reward them.
You're making me smile because I'm going to tell you stories I used to work in financial services where I think, and maybe this is one of the reasons why I left, is that they hired pigs, just driven by cash.
Right, right.
Now, explain that to me. They were very, very successful. They made lots and lots of money.
Well, look at the example of Enron back in the early 2000s, the greatest corporate crash of all time. And some of their values were integrity and honesty. And look what happened then. They were thieves, complete thieves. So to me, the values are interdependent. No one value on its own is enough. It's the interplay of those values when they work together. So going after cash only, yes, of course, every business wants to deliver its KPIs, its return on investment. I get that. And by the way, I'm completely commercial. I want to get the return on investment. But at the same time, it's how you do that. So if the focus of those pigs is going after cash only, but they're leaving a trail of destruction behind them and impacting on other people's lives in a negative way, that's not okay.
But it's very good for them. I watched one particular company, nothing to do with me now, and I was not anybody I worked with or for or anything like that. Their business grew and grew and grew, even though there was this massive trail of destruction behind it.
Absolutely. And look, that is absolutely true. And you see it also in certain airlines. You see it also in certain businesses where there seems to be this aggressive, very, very power-driven culture. And yes, they can be successful. But for me, though, there's a much, much greater balance around that. And it's all about the impact on society, impact on the people that work in the organization, impact on customers. Because take that guy, those pigs in the financial services who are totally...
I'm never going to work in that business again, am I?
Totally driven by cash. The chances are, look, why was there a new policy brought into the financial services world of needs-based selling and not overselling? Why was that? It was because there were many of those guys who were just going after the cash only, and they were mis-selling to customers in order to get cash. So it does have an impact, Conall, in some way. So it's short-term rather than long-term.
That is secret number one, culture. Secret number two.
Well, I mean, if I have what I call a 7 steps to profit, and step number one in that seven steps...
Sorry, I'm just going to cut across here. Yeah. You made Selfridges a lot of money with that, didn't you?
Well, indeed. Well, I was very, 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 very privileged to be a significant lead consultant from an external perspective on the massive change that went on there at the time when the Weston family bought the business. But it was very definitely a team effort, and there was an incredibly strong and successful and a fantastic leader in Paul Kelly.
And no pigs there.
No pigs there. No pigs there. Absolutely.
No, sorry, as usual, I cut across.
Oh, okay.
Sorry.
And it's delightful. My 7 steps to profit starts with step number one, which is all about having a clearly defined North Star. So that's knowing exactly who you are as a brand.
That is a phrase that drives me to distraction. Your North Star.
North Star, right. Would you like me to give you a different version of the same thing?
Please.
What about vision and mission?
Okay,
what about
that.
Brand DNA? What about singing off the same hymn sheet? What about strong positioning within the competitive matrix so that you know exactly? So, for example, if you want to join a retail business, Brown Thomas and Primark are at opposite ends of the scale, proudly so, nothing wrong with that. But they've got a very, very clearly defined North Star. So Bridget Donoghue was here last week with you, and she talked very clearly about them being a value proposition.
She was fantastic.
She was thunderous. Fantastic. But Primark Pennies is very definitely a value proposition, and proudly so, whereas Brown Thomas is a luxury brand. And that is having a clearly defined North Star. So to me, whether you are a small business, which many, look, 90, plus percent of businesses around Ireland, just because it's Brown Thomas and Primark who have millions and millions of revenue, it doesn't mean it shouldn't apply to you if your turnover is only 200 grand. The same concept of being very clear about who you want to be when you grow up as a business. Who are you aspiring to? What messaging do you want to convey? Because when you get that clear then, when it comes to people coming into your business, you then get a better fit.
So I am Alan O'Neill, news agent.
Right.
And I have two or three part-time employees who come in, do shifts and all. How do I get them to adopt what you're saying? Or is that possible?
It's absolutely possible. And I often give the example of going into some of the symbol type stores like Spar, Super Value, etc. And very often you go into those, and I know the owner, I've worked with BWG and Musgrave, and I know what they're trying to convey in their messaging from a brand perspective. And yet, when you go down to the ground, you might see some students who have been brought in for part-time work. And by the way, I love the concept of bringing in students, but give them an opportunity to succeed rather than just putting a t-shirt on them and sticking them in behind the counter and training them on the till.
So what would you do?
Well, I would absolutely, first of all, convey to them context. People get context. When you position your brand in the mind of even a 17-year-old and say, here's how we want our customers to be treated. Here's the brand that we are. And quality or the way we speak to customers is important. Having that, even if it's only an afternoon or a couple of hours of a conversation, you tell people what you expect. If you don't tell them what you expect, then they might not make eye contact. They might not put the change in the customer's hand, although COVID times are different. But you know what I'm saying? So it's to give them that clarity.
And if they don't listen?
Well, then I'd fire them.
Okay, well, that was
quick. Be very, very clear about it. Absolutely.
Secret number three.
No, yes, indeed. No, look, I mean, yeah, for sure. Violence is the best transfer for it in every case. I mean. But no, seriously, look, to my mind, everybody deserves a yellow card. One yellow card. I fundamentally believe in people. I believe people are basically good. And I believe people come to work, no matter what the job is, wanting to do a good job. Why don't they? Well, I blame the employer more than I blame the employee. Because if they don't create the environment or tell people, what chance do they have?
That is exactly what Breege O'Donoghue said, is that she was 37 years, I think, with Primark. And she said she never came across a bad employee, but she came across a couple of managers.
Bad leaders.
Who were not exactly up to scratch, which is interesting.
And it sounds cliched, but it's not. It's true.
Secret number three, where I think we're on.
So, followed on from the having a clearly defined North Star, sorry, Conall, North Star, followed by culture. And culture comes before strategy. Why? Because the world outside is changing at a rapid pace, Conall. And for that reason, you need to change and update your strategy every year. The days of the 3 and 5 or 10 year strategy are pretty much gone, because the best you can forecast now is about a year, a full cycle of your industry cycle. And that's typically a year. So 400 days is the best you can forecast. However, you still need to look beyond that to maybe a 3 or 5 year vista. But what I do working with my clients is I get them to revisit that strategy every year. So therefore, it's a rolling 3 year strategy. And that, to me, is why strategy comes after culture. Culture doesn't change every year. Culture is embedded. It's your DNA. It's the way you behave. It's the way you think. And that doesn't change every year. So step number one is a clearly defined North Star. Step number two is culture. Step number three is strategy. And then step number four is people and the organization structure. Because structure can change. If, for example, you and I decide to invest in a new territory, we're going to open in Italy, we might need to hire a new person. Instantly, that changes the organization structure. The org charts. So org charts and people and the right people in the right boxes, etc., comes as step number four. Moving on to step number five is about connecting with your customer.
This is the add-on, because we're only going to do four, but
The four in the book is different. The four in the book is taking culture and breaking that out. So would you like to go into the culture?
Go into the book, because what I'm trying to do is save them the price of the book.
That's
correct.
You did say that, even though it's only 20 quid, Conall, but let's do our best to save them a few, Bob. Right. Let's save your listeners. So the four, come back to my point about values. So remember, culture is built on the spine of values. And in my experience over my 30 years, Conall, I'm recognizing that there are certain values that are being missed everywhere I go. And there are four that I want to call out. And those four are customer centricity, and I'll explain as much as you like in a second. Customer centricity. Another one is accountability, where people take real ownership. A third one is respect. And a fourth one is agility. So that moving at pace.
So you have 2 minutes total to discuss the entire four.
Okay. So customer centricity, although it sounds cliched, is critically important. For example, look at Disney in Florida. Walt Disney stood at the entrance to Disney and watched families walking through. And he counted how many steps it took them to open another suite. And based on that, you'll find the bins in Disney are roughly every 21 paces. They're not just placed where they look best or where they might just fit in from a structural point of view. It's customer centric.
I love the pieces of information people have in their heads.
I know, it's crazy, isn't it? But that's a real example, a true example of customer centricity. And it doesn't matter whether you're a multi-billion business like Disney or a small SME, the same message applies. Accountability is, remember, every business needs to get a return on its investment. Payroll is very expensive. So you need to have your people accountable so that they can justify their presence. And the way to do that is to be very clear, make it very clear as to what you expect of people and make sure that they've got metrics and delivering on those. For example, I work with a fantastic small food company here where there's a fantastic salesperson in one territory. And every time I chair a steering group for a culture refresh, and she's on that, whenever I look for a volunteer to do something, hands up from this particular person. She's just a rock star. And she always follows through, delivers on time, and does exactly, she shows up. The third one then is respect. And of course, this concept of respect, we know it's so important in life in a general point. But I'm working with a large company in the UK right now, and the CEO is fantastic because he has an incredible balance. This is John Edgar in a company called Fennec, a department store chain. And John has a great balance between support and challenge. He's a challenging leader. He sets the stall very high, high standards and so on. But he's incredibly supportive at the same time in terms of enabling people and being empathic when they need be. And that's that great sense of respect, as opposed to the opposite, where you've got leaders that are role modeling just bad behaviors. Fourth one, agility. So if you take that concept of agility, there's a fantastic restaurant in Talbot Street, an Italian restaurant that closed down during lockdown, obviously. But the owner, Leone, she then pivoted, that famous word, over to build a catering business. Now, there's lots of them that do that, but she went further. She had this fantastic dessert that has glowberries on it. It became such a success that Brown Thomas came to her and said, we want to stock your glowberries. And that to me is a terrific example of agility. It's turning quickly and having a sense of urgency and pace about you.
You did it in 2 minutes.
Did I really?
You certainly did.
I shocked myself.
Two things. You better tell people why they have to buy your book.
Well, because you challenged me to give just a quick summary in 2 minutes. Well, there's so much more. I wrote this book, actually. This is my second book. I wrote it as a parable. And I wrote it as a story to
make
it easy to read.
It's actually very easy to read, actually.
Thank you. Yeah. Well, rather than just having a reference book, which is a typical business
book. No, you go on a little journey, don't you?
It rambles through. I take it down the River Shannon in Ireland. And through a process of discovery and conversations, this particular character called Don, the consultant, gives feedback to his client about what he discovered. And he discovered that there are four values that they're missing. They're missing a big trick on. So in a very, very nice, calm storytelling format, you will learn so much more. And many of the people that have read the book are coming back saying, crikey, that example you gave, are you sure you weren't talking about me when you said that? And because they're so typical.
And there are so many similarities in the businesses.
Indeed.
Now, you know, the final question we always ask is, who would Alan O'Neill hire in a heartbeat?
Well, I did give this a lot of thought, and there was one particular person.
If you say Richard Branson, I'm going to kill
you.
No, I'm not. Because everybody says Richard
Branson. Well,
I
guarantee you, no. There's a couple of people, and one I'm not allowed to mention, because if I mention this person, she'd be chased by competitors. So, but I'd love to mention this girl. She's fantastic. But I will mention.
Oh, come on.
I know. But I will mention.
Give me a hint. She married you.
None of those things. But I will mention a very good client called Martin Tobin. Martin is the chief executive of European Recycling Platform, which is an Irish division of a global group called Landbell Group. And Martin is the chief executive of the Irish operation. Now, they engaged me to help them refresh the culture for the whole global company. And he was asked to be the internal champion. So he's my tic-tac. I'm external and he's the inside guy. But what his handle on culture, without having to go and learn it like I've done over 30 years and learning through discovery and all sorts of ways, he has an instinctive handle on culture and human behavior. So as a consultant in the world of change management, I'd hire him in a heartbeat to come along and support me on change management projects.
Martin, you're hired.
Exactly.
Very nice. That's lovely. Alan, his book is called... Where is it here?
Culture Matters.
Culture Matters. And it's not a huge book. It's a nice...
You'd read it in 2 evenings.
And it's a nice, gentle read as well, as you correctly say. Alan O'Neill of Culture Matters and also of Cara with a K Consulting. And also, obviously, told me to say this twice, of the Sunday Independent. Thank you so much for joining us on That Great Business Show.
And thank you, too.
And that the great business insights on That Great Business Show are brought only through the support of De Facto Shaving Oil, makers of the world's best shaving oil. Switch from unhealthy shaving foams to all natural shaving oil and you will save your skin, your pocket and your planet. Check out defactoshave.com.
ISME is the independent SME association looking after the interests of all types of businesses across Ireland. ISME membership includes invaluable HR and general advice, training, promotional tools, members' discounts, events and networking with fellow SMEs. ISME membership starts from €195 with easy pay options. ISME. Join today at isme.ie or email membership@isme.ie.
I love finding out from entrepreneurs where their big business ideas come from. For example, who would have thought there was a business in creating forests that are only 6 square meters in size? That's about 65 square feet in old money, or tiny, tiny in anyone's language. Pocket Forests was set up in 2020 by events manager Ash Conrad-Jones and journalist and author Catherine Cleary, that many of you will know from her column in the Irish Times. The company has a goal of improving biodiversity in urban areas using something called the permaculture methods to regenerate depleted soil and plant a diverse range of native trees and shrubs to recreate a forest in small pockets of land. I love it, and I hope for them that there's money in it. So, I suppose, let's find out by asking Ash and Catherine. First of all, you're very welcome to That Great Business Show, Ash, August, Catherine.
Thanks, Noel.
Thank you.
Lovely to be here.
Lovely to be here.
Whose idea was it?
Well, it was...
That's Ash. Yeah. I have to identify your voices, first of all.
I think organically, it's both of our ideas. We would never have done it without the other.
Somebody said, you're sitting over a glass of wine or a cup of coffee or something, somebody said, here's an idea.
We came across the tiny forest method, which is the Miyawaki method, started in Japan in the 1970s. And that got us really excited because we've both been very anxious about climate change and the biodiversity crisis. And it just seemed like a very doable idea. So we just decided that we would give it a go. And we started with doing some test plots to see whether the idea would work. We were kindly given lots of help from IVN, which is doing tiny forests in the Netherlands. They've done amazing projects over there. So we got some great training and tips from them and from all their experience. And it just kind of progressed organically, didn't it?
Yeah, well, definitely. I have got most things wrong about you so far, Ash, as in I decided that you're from New Zealand. You're not. You're obviously from Australia. And there were loads of other things that I said about you. You said, that's not me. I was doing a little bit of digging, as I would normally do, around both of you. I didn't get the sense that both of you were hugely knowledgeable about gardens, trees, stuff like that. I'm trying to say it very gently.
I know. You're completely right. Yeah. Yes. I mean, part of the reason it did sprout organically was that both of our businesses or industries were completely obliterated, you know, in March 2020 when COVID hit, because Ash was in the events business. I was in the business of going to restaurants and writing about them. And suddenly, neither of those worlds existed. And I suppose... we were also on a 2K lockdown in the least green part of Ireland. And then this idea dropped into our heads and our lives. And we just thought, well,
we'd love if somebody was doing this in Dublin. And in that typical way of setting up a business, if somebody isn't doing that in Dublin, let's do this.
Which makes sense.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And nobody else is doing this.
There are a few people. Antashka have done a couple with schools in Limerick. So we started talking to everybody who was doing it.
But that's a different kind of, this is, you're a business.
Yes. Yeah. And the Netherlands was the real inspiration for our very, that 6 square meter forest, because they were calling it a toonie forest, which is, and toonie is Dutch for garden. So they had taken this idea of the tiny forest, which was the tennis court sized urban forest. And then they were also doing almost as a sideline, this toonie forest for your garden. So we were very lucky. I suppose we've lots of friends. I'm thinking of Aideen, who works in the social entrepreneur field. And she was saying there's a wonderful idea where you buy something and then you give something. So could you have a garden model where people with plenty of space and lovely gardens would buy a garden, and that would give it to maybe people in parts of the city where there wasn't that kind of resource, and that we could do that. So we started, our business model at the start was that we would plant in private gardens this very small, beautiful native shrub and tree planting. And then we would go bigger into other parts of the city.
And did that work?
Yes, it did, on a small scale.
Oh, no, yeah.
Yeah.
But why aren't you doing that now?
Well,
we love a pivot. Was there a pivot involved?
I suppose, and we had great support from from our local social enterprise. I'm thinking of Michelle, who's with that social enterprise group in the part of our city. They were great.
If you give all these people a second name, they're going to love you even more.
Michelle's name is difficult. It's Lichiardi.
We're not sure how to pronounce it.
Sorry, Michelle. And a lot of it has been online. So we went down the road of talking about marketing ideas, and we realized to get to that market of becoming landscapers, I suppose, which is what we would do, would require a lot of resources. It would also be quite an expensive service because you had to factor in the time that we would spend to come in, design the forest, prepare the soil, and then plant it in bare root season. So
we operate more on a forest timetable or a tree timetable than a people one. So there is time involved in it, and it's as we all know, it's labor and time that costs a lot of money and is what people don't want to spend on.
So I don't normally ask people on the show deliberately about how much they charge, because that's kind of like business and we don't want to give away your business secrets. Is it an expensive service?
When we costed it and looked at the time, yes. I mean, we had wonderful private clients for our first year, and we've been into their lives and their gardens, and it was really great, because the people who came to us and said, yes, we'd like a tiny forest or a pocket forest in our garden, were really, you know, our kinds of people. They were brilliant. Fantastic. A shout out to all our pioneer clients, as we call them. So, you know, we were working it out in terms of the local conditions, accessing the actual trees as well, which was quite a difficult thing because they're grown at scale for agricultural planting as opposed to nursery.
But you started off, was it just planting people's gardens?
Yes.
Yeah.
So Mrs. Smith, living on Smith Road, she would say to you, put a forest in there, please.
Yep.
Okay.
And we also worked with a school in our area as well, Mercy College in Inchicore. Because they had plenty of space.
Now that's the issue, because even if it's only 6 square meters, land in a city is always at a premium. Mm-hmm. And I'm imagining that the last thing anybody wants to put on it is a forest, if you can put any kind of a portaloo or anything at all, a porta cabin on.
Yeah, unfortunately, yes.
But
that's not a business.
Well, that goes against all the economics of trees, because if you look at the studies, if you put trees in your street, you get less crime, you get healthier air, you get cleaner air, you get better, you know, you get happier people.
No, we're all for better and nicer, but if there's a 6 square meter plot, and if somebody can imagine that they could get an apartment or something there, isn't that what's going to go in there?
And your property values are also going to increase when you have trees in your garden or on your street.
And you have managed to get into the digital hub. Mm-hmm. Yeah, tell me about that one. That's really interesting.
Yeah, the digital hub have been fantastic. They're part of what's called Smart D8, which is this really cool idea around
D8 for Dublin 8.
Dublin 8, bringing together all kinds of fresh thinking about health. So, because there are so many hospitals in our area, we've got James's, we've got the Children's Hospital,
You will have a children's
We will hub. Someday. There is this wonderful thing called Smart D8. The digital hub are right in the center of this. And they've allowed us to put in a tiny, very tiny tree nursery of native trees.
Did I see that it's in a skip?
Part of it is in a skip.
Yeah, we have a forest planted in a skip.
You better give, is it Thorntons who have given
That's
you the
right.
skip?
Yeah, you
very better
kindly.
Give them a shout out because they're going to love you more.
Yes, we got the what we call the apocalyptic skip donated from Thorntons, which is actually perfect for what we wanted to do.
It's a skip and it's full of trees now, is it?
Yeah. So why did you
use a skip?
Well, there's a fabulous skip garden in London that we use as inspiration, and the digital hub don't have any access to soil. They don't want to dig into the ground. So they really wanted a pocket forest. So rather than spend thousands, literally thousands, building a container in which to put the forest in, we've done this. And they've been very supportive because it hasn't been done before.
Is the skip the size of this room maybe, is it, or smaller?
It's a 6 cubic yard skip.
Oh, here.
It unfortunately comes in yards for some weird reason.
But there's a seat on the front of it now where the lip would be on a skip for loading is now a beautifully
So you sit
wind.
Into your little forest, is it?
Yes. Yeah.
Now,
you,
of course, you're going to tell me, yes, they do. But honestly, do people sit on it and use it?
We have seen people sitting on it and use it. Yeah. It's a nice little lunch spot.
Now, that is lovely when the digital hub hires you for that. But where is your, you know, what they call in business, the sweet spot? Who do you want? What would you like to have as a client? Everybody I know, but ideally.
People with land and money, really.
Okay.
They're the clients we're looking for, yeah.
I mean, it would be fabulous to have a developer on board, you know, who are putting in these developments. And instead of seeing the lone trees, I mean, this is something we've come across again and again with the kids that we've been working with. They're like, planting trees together, and it blows their mind. They think that trees come singly and that they don't.
I never thought of that.
Yeah.
Now we get an even nicer idea about this. How many of your trees go into your 6 square meters? I mean, are we talking about
11?
Okay.
11 trees and shrubs and 11 different species.
Into the
6 square meters.
Okay.
Pot.
And therefore, when you get into a larger area.
So a tennis roughly court. 3 per square meter. So depending on how large.
Because trees grow.
Yeah.
Yes,
they do. Everybody's freaked out by that, but that's part of the thing that makes this fantastic for us, because, you know, a question we've been talking about recently is, you know, who looks after the trees? And the answer is the trees look after the trees.
They do, of course. Yeah. They stand there, they do their thing. Yeah. And
they look after us while they're doing it as well.
And part of the Miyawaki method is you let the forest develop how it would develop. So you have a mix of pioneer species and slower growing species, and each forest will develop in its own way. And, you know, at the end of 50 years or whatever, you'll have different trees that are thriving in different forests. But it's very much, I mean, Catherine and I ask ourselves all the time, like you were saying at the beginning, you know, what do we know? Well, we approach those questions with, well, what does a forest do? And what would a forest do? And then we find out answer by starting with that question.
So the business, though, is digging holes.
No.
We don't dig.
We don't dig holes.
No digging.
Permaculture, it's a no-dig method. So like 50% of our...
Really?
Yeah. So 50% of our work is in the soil. And we've turned around grey rubble in 2 months into this lush, delicious soil to plant by using this permaculture method of where you aerate the soil.
Aerating means that you have to fork it.
You just fork, and it's just even half a fork deep, and you just pull the fork back. No lifting, nothing. You just lift it, and then it's just enough for the nutrients to get into the soil a
bit.
And
do you put the nutrients in?
Yeah, and then we've got a different recipe according to what that looks like the soil needs. And we kind of like, they call it in America like a lasagna method. So you layer these methods, and then we have been putting the soil then to sleep under the coffee sacks. And you leave it for a couple of months, 3 months if possible, and the soil will work itself out. And you leave the grass there or whatever, the nettles or whatever, and you trample them down and you keep them there because all of that nutrients goes back into the soil. I mean,
all of their roots create little air holes as well for the soil to become like a forest floor, because that's what we want. We want a forest floor when we come to plant our young trees.
We are not Monty Don or Ask About Gardening. We are a business show.
We keep going off on one about soils.
How many clients do you need to make this a viable business? Or is this, as the Americans would say, a side hustle? Like when events start again, you'll be going back eventing. The restaurants are open again. So you are writing.
Not about restaurants. I've handed my fork over to the wonderful Corinna Hardgrave, who's now writing the restaurant column in the Irish Times.
Correct, but so you are doing the sustainability.
Sustainability column, yeah.
See, I read it.
Thank you, I'm so happy. That makes me very happy. Yeah, it's a very good question, actually, that side hustle question, because I'm fascinated by side hustles. More interesting.
It's not a fascinating question. I want an answer.
We both want this to become our bread and butter.
Yeah.
Yeah. That is the answer. But at the moment, it's
12 months in a year. And of those at least three, even in our silly climate, there's not a lot happening in a garden. So it's a 9 month year.
Oh, no, there are busy months because that's when we're planting. That's bare root season, you see.
Yeah. So go back to how many gardens do you need to make a living?
I haven't crunched the numbers on that. The good news is that we've been...
if you were on the Dragon's Den, you'd be going out the door.
We would fail. I know.
Deborah Meaton, she's the lady. She said, what? You haven't done the numbers?
Well, going back to your pivot, we have been happily pivoting with our partnership with the Digital Hub. We've also received some funding from the Department of Agriculture because they have a wonderful woodland support fund. So we're going to be working with 20 communities around Ireland to put in these pocket forests, and they will be funded by the Department of Agriculture, which is wonderful. So we then have to work out in terms of capacity. And obviously what we'd love to do with this is also create green jobs and actually have people who are trained to do this and can go and do this, to thousands of gardens. The other very business-minded product that we have, hopefully be able to develop now that we have the funding, is a pack of trees that we can send to people with full instructions. So obviously that spreads the idea much further because there are only so many that we could plant. I mean, we can plant a lot, but obviously if we can send them to very keen gardeners. And I think it is one, it's a little bit like a meal kit. I think it's something that people will actually really enjoy getting their hands on and being able to, prepare the soil, and then their tree pack arrives in the depths of winter. They plant them, they look like dead sticks, and then spring comes and the magic happens.
I am going to connect you. But one of the things we do on the show is we are called TeamGBS because you have now joined TeamGBS, that great business show. And we had a lady on from Hackettstown, County Carlow, with her family nursery. I know that you two would get on famously with her.
Excellent.
So I shall connect you there because I've noticed yet again, Catherine, you haven't actually answered how many gardens you need.
We'd probably need about 2,000.
But what you have told me is that you're going to go national with it.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not being smart when I say international because Martin Nocton, the billionaire businessman, always says Northern Ireland is your first export market.
Wow, funny you should say that because we've already gone up there.
Have you?
Yes.
So you are exporters.
All Ireland.
All Ireland.
But you have, if you go, that's exporting.
Yeah, well.
Probably get a tax break. Another one.
we did a fabulous project, we haven't planted yet, with the Niagra Falls up in Niagara, through the Acre Foundation,
Yeah.
Did you say the Niagra Falls?
The Niagra Falls, yes.
As in convicts?
Yes. They're former political prisoners. They were all in Crumlin Road Jail together.
Yeah.
I have never come across, I love this podcast because I learned so much. And so you are working with these guys and they are planting a forest, are they?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
One or many?
They're planting one half quart size, so 150 trees.
I know it goes against the grain, but what's the biggest forest you'd like to plant? I mean, what's the biggest pocket?
300 trees,
300
tennis court.
Half a tennis court.
Because
really,
we do a permaculture soil preparation, it's too much work to do any bigger than that.
And did I read correctly that you also cut a path through it?
We work with the clients to even with the small ones, you can make like a kidney shape so that you can have a little chair in there and maybe have the trees feel like your trees are going on. But right from the start, inner city kids and inner city people, they don't know what it's like to be in a forest and to be covered with trees. I mean, that single tree thing is a classic. And so right from the start, we're like, you have to have these, you have to be able to go into the forest and feel like
you're getting a hug.
Yeah.
Forest hug.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's another woman. She's down in Roscarbury and she does forest bathing. Mm. Mm-hmm. I'll remember her name in a while now, but I mean to have her on the podcast. Come here to me. There's a couple of other things we have to do before we let you go. First of all, you're asked, what would you like Team GBS to do for you?
Well, I think you've already done it, Conall. Thank you by getting us to focus our business minds.
I'm going to connect you with Deborah Meaden. Deborah Meaden is going to crunch you around the place.
Crunch those numbers. And I suppose just to get people to understand the value of trees and to love them as much as we do. That is our mission. And not just trees, but forests. And to really, if you're interested in this topic at all, go and, you know, read any book. The Hidden Life of Trees is the one that people have read a lot. Peter Volbon, he's an Austrian forester. It's an amazing book. And it will make you look at trees completely differently.
Yeah. And I think that's a big thing for us too, because we plant bare roots and we want to, those trees are seen as having no value. And going back to the business thing, we do think that's what's really important, that we get paid for this work, because but even just for the value to go back into that tree, I mean, a tree that is 2 foot tall and doesn't have any leaves on it is that...
That's your whip.
That 20-metre tree that you see down the road.
I mean, in terms of a business story, it reminds me a little bit of where Irish food might have been maybe 15 years ago, where people would have looked at Irish food ingredients and gone, oh, who would pay money for those?
Yes, yes.
And now, actually, what people love and will pay enormous amounts of money for is that Irish ingredient, that weed that's been picked off the side of the road and beautifully arranged on a plate.
You've got to go back to the lady that I had on, whose name I've forgotten, but she's a forager for Glendalough Distillery. Mm-hmm. And that is that's her business.
Yeah.
She forages.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah. Mm. And people are so proud of that connection to the food that's around them. And I think we need to get that pride in our native trees, even just be able to identify them and say, and I've got these native trees in my garden. And not only will you love them, but every life form in your garden will love them as well.
Now, I'm hoping, and it hasn't always worked this way, that both of you have read the email that I sent you. And I did say to you, I would be asking you a final question, which is, who would you hire in a heartbeat? Have you got one each or one collectively?
Collectively.
Okay. Who have you gone for?
David Oakes.
David Oakes. If you're listening.
Who?
He is an actor.
David?
Oakes.
David Oakes. He's an actor. He's spent quite a bit of time in Ireland because he was shooting Vikings. So he's a Viking. Mm. But he has a wonderful podcast called Trees a Crowd. And he just tells the story of trees and talks in an incredibly entertaining fashion about trees and has a wonderful singer called Bella Hardy who sings about trees. And so we'd like him to be our podcaster partner, David.
Yeah.
That makes a lot of sense. We will track him down for you because Team GBS knows everybody. And we have listeners in Australia, South Africa, across the States. We have them everywhere. It's mad and fantastic. I love it, love it, love it. Now, that was, well, they still are, but they were Catherine Cleary and Ash Conrad-Jones. And their business is called?
Pocket Forests.
And they will find you?
Pocketforests.ie.
Okay, well, that's easy.
Yeah.
And there's no funny PHs or anything else. No.
None of those.
Thank you so much for joining us on That Great Business Show, both of you. And that is it from That Great Business Show, episode 48. As always, my thanks to the team here at the Dublin Podcast Studio, home of Ireland's best podcast sound engineers. Rob Curry was today's studio sound engineer, and later Peter Rice will add in jingles and tinkles. Thanks to them both. My thanks to Eileen O'Brien at Orpen Press for sending me Alan O'Neill's book. Catherine and Ash came courtesy of an article in the Irish Times that one of our team spotted. And P or Gillian Wright yet again sent us a cracker in Cat Butler. Lots of you in business are starting your own podcasts. Now, that's our business. So if you would like us to produce a world-class podcast for you, do please get in touch. We also want your ads. And if you want to talk to Ireland's SME community, That Great Business Show is the way to do it. Email producer at thatgreatbusinessshow.com, where you can find out all about our great value advertising packages. And of course, as always, if you know of a great business that should be featured on Ireland's best business podcast, please do not hesitate. Tell us all about it on the website or via our LinkedIn pages. I was just giving out to both Ash and to Catherine about not being on LinkedIn. LinkedIn is where you do business. Go for it. And finally, my thanks to our sponsor, DeFactoShave.com, the world's best shaving oil. Try it for just 1 week, and like me, you will be a forever convert. And from me, Conall O Móráin, until next week, slán.